And now we go back to Czechoslovakia. Vendula Hnitkova, since 2006, Vendula has worked as a researcher in the Institute of Art History in the Czech Academy of Sciences. And now she moved to England, and she takes part in the project of anyway, you take project in the University of Birmingham. Yeah. Her research focuses on the history and historiography of modern architecture in the 20th century and its social, political, and economic context, especially in Central Europe. Publications by Vendula include Moscow 1937, Architecture and Propaganda from the Western Perspective, and, which is very important in our case, National Style, Arts and Politics. The floor is yours, and the title of presentation is Czech Modern Architecture and the Long Shadow of Karel Taige. We switch from neo-traditionalism to avant-garde.
Thank you for inviting me to Kaunas, which I visited 19 years ago when I was a student, so now I'm able for the first time to see the modernism actually with open eyes. And I would like to say that I will be speaking about national style, which some of you have already became familiar with yesterday in the talk by Vladimir Šlapeta, which was called Rondo Cubism or something. I unfortunately missed that one contribution, but I would like to emphasize today that the problem with national style isn't rooted in its decorative ornamentations, but in its nationalist issues. The early 1920s were a turbulent period in Czechoslovakia. Establishing the independent republic on a national basis implemented a permanent scar in its newly proclaimed identity, caused immediate conflicts with its neighboring countries, and moreover, launched fundamental tensions with its numerous minorities. The dynamic development in politics was vividly reflected in visual culture. Parallel to establishing the Czechoslovak Republic, some of Czech architects and designers manifested victorious achievements of the historical moment in their artistic production. It was a newly gained patriotism expressed with architectural means. Yet decades later, where these artistic endeavors from the early 1920s perceived through a lens of a cultural distaste, lacking any critical distance or any aim of contextual interpretation, the negative attitude toward national style was deeply rooted in the original statements of a respected theorist, Karel Taige. National style was a product of its period. Its ideological intentions were shaped by a long tradition of Czech national movement dating back to the 19th century that formed a significant DNA of Czech mentality that might be perceived even today. National style was literally invented by architect Pavel Janák, already mentioned by Matthew. Acknowledged Czech architect who had shaped the local urban landscape for more than five decades in the first half of the 20th century. Janák was one of the Otto Wagner students at the Academy in Vienna, originating from the Czech lands. Both before the and after the First World War, Pavel Janák was the prolific spokesperson of the modern movement and is considered the leading theoretician of architectural cubism and national style. His personal involvement in creating a new style appropriate to the independent republic also explains one of its names, Rondo Cubism, that links the post-war architecture with the pre-war Cubist period, whose was Janák a chief protagonist. Although I need to add that Render Cubism is only one from a whole group of some 12 to 15 names given to this artistic production of 1920s. Already during the last year of the First World War, Pavel Janák outlined a program of a post-war recovery in the field of architecture and design. In his essay, Ve třetině cesty, In a Third of a Way, published in 1918, Janák summarized architecture development in the 20th century up to then and defined the ultimate target in forming national art. According to Janák, the architects are obliged to consider social needs of the nation, the local conditions, and also usefulness. You see the usefulness on the pictures. Fulfilling these particular factors would eventually transform architecture, and I quote, from a pure art into a national art. In his another article, Národní věc a čeští architekti, National Issue and the Czech Architects, also from 1918, Janák formulated a new objective, namely for architecture to penetrate into the national life, into the national ideas. Janák's opinion found a vivid recognition among his friends, especially among those joined in the Svaz Československého díla, which is a Czechoslovak parallel to the German Werkbund, and at the Academy of Applied Arts in Prague, where Janák even became a rector in the 1920s. For the national style is symptomatic a search for inspiration in Czech cultural legacy, and especially in the folk art. A positive appropriation of vernacular tradition became a kind of mass phenomenon after the foundation of Czechoslovakia, but artists who developed the national style yet found another support in the work of influential art historian Zdeněk Wirt. In his essays, Wirt appreciated the political importance of the rural class in the 19th century when they performed a significant segment of the national democratic society, according to his opinion. Furthermore, Wirt celebrated the folk culture in terms that can be also applied to national style. I quote, "We can see a large supply of elements and motifs, the distinctive way of their stylization, amazing color sense, but moving in a poor and typographically limited number of tones, a practical, even natural ability showing the application of ornamental decoration and, at the same time, a naive conception everywhere where high principles of artistic composition and creations of forms are concerned." And how did Janák and his friends translate the theory into architectural practice? You already know the crematorium. National style is usually marked by robust volumes, rich decoration of surfaces, and all that underlined by intense and contrast colors. The most important public buildings are even decorated by a rich variety of sculptures. Although the ornaments are an overwhelming feature and eye-catching phenomena, the national style architecture is often derived not only from vernacular sources, but also from historical styles, which is an issue that the architects never admitted. As a symptomatic example of national style, I will present you today Palace Adria in Prague that represents all controversies related not only to the decorative solution of the building, but also to the nationalist ideology that the style manifested, and which we are not able to decode today purely on the aesthetic solution. The complete title of the structure is Riunione Adriatica di Sicurta, which was an Italian insurance company operating in the post-Habsburg monarchy. For the Prague headquarters, the company first commissioned an esteemed architect, Josef Caše, who was a Czechoslovak citizen but of a German nationality. His artistic expression associated with his German origin proved to be a too problematic factor, which met with a radical public opposition. After an intense media campaign launched by several Czech cultural associations, the insurance company rather reconsidered appointing architect Caše. Instead, the financial institution announced an invited competition for prominent and exclusively Czech architects. And these properly selected architects were asked to redesign exterior of the building, which proved to be a problematic issue in the public space of central Prague. Then the competition won Pavel Janák. In the design by Janák, he conceived a true monument in terms of meaning and also its scale in the urban context. His concept solves the given large volume of the structure by alteration of forwarding and receding vertical masses. The Italian origin of the insurance company, Janák, highlighted by apparently Italian-alike turrets with flat ending and battlements on its perimeter. Facades were covered with plastic ornaments in forms of triangles, circles, or arcs, and painted in a combination of dark red and a shade of white, which are Czech national colors. All decorative system was completed by displaying dozens of sculptures by the most acknowledged Czech sculptors of the day. After all the public pressures, Janák's design, apparently getting near to the eclectic architecture of the 19th century, was far more acceptable than the project of Josef Caše, the Czechoslovak architect of German nationality. But already before its completion in 1925, the structure was ridiculed by many foreign members of the avant-garde movement. Le Corbusier, when in the 1920s visited Prague, he stared at a new building of a fortress character with relief decorations, showing how the local official architecture still continues in an outdated and progress-denying spirit. Also, Belgian architect Henry van der Velde's comment on the palace was simple, and he marked the building as a mere stage design. Also, the Czech critics started to approach the concept of a Czech character in art from openly negative positions. National style was now revealed as a false ideological construct, and its chief enemy became a Czech member of international network of avant-garde, Karel Taige. Some of his friends ridiculed his name as Charles Tej. He crucified the insurance company headquarters in following words. Janák's palace, Reunione Adriatica, will remain the most characteristic and most convicting proof of the delusion of this nationally decorative school. A building overladen with decorations, which are, as a matter of fact, has no national individuality and originality in itself, but is a rather an utterly historical construction for its whole spirit. Some hideous and monstrous miramare, equipped with odd battlements which look like a box of chocolates or an inlaid case from afar. Karel Taige's rejection on national style was not based only on aesthetic principles nor on rejection of nationalist position, but primarily on ethical reasons. Manufacturing all decorative elements is for Taige a pure waste of manpower and material, and in this sense is such architecture utterly old-fashioned. Yet in 1933, in a rigid chart, Taige classified the main international and local trends in the modern architecture, and his approach was of a scientist. In the chart, he confronted various architects and their production and labeled it as a more or less progressive, as if there was only one appropriate and approved way of designing buildings. So you see, Le Corbusier is the main hero of avant-garde, and then there is a big impact of Soviet constructivism that Taige explored already in 1925 when he visited Soviet Union, and then there is the ridiculed national style by Josef Gočar and Pavel Janák. In the same time, in his classical work, Modern Architecture, Karel Taige described Czech architecture in its historical development, and in a sense, his critical attitudes established a lasting monopoly on its proper interpretation. Taige's imperative statements and evaluation had not only an impact on his contemporaries, but proved to be influential for many upcoming decades of Czech historiography. He defined a narrative that was appropriated by generations of Czech art historians.